So, like I said, for our routine cataract surgery patients, we all use toric lenses to treat significant and regular corneal astigmatism. It's become more of a norm. And yet we come across situations where we are not very certain whether using the toric lens would be the right choice for this particular patient or not. And hence, in today's talk, I'm going to share with you some such unique experiences that we have learned some very important lessons from. The first patient I share with you is somebody who had a compromised cornea. A young female who came to us with a complaint of blurred vision and a history of being a myope all her life. She had actually undergone an RK surgery many years ago, again gone back to using glasses and not very happy about that. So when we evaluated her and saw that she had a significant and operable cataract along with this 8 radial keratotomy marks, when we evaluated her preoperatively, we were really not surprised to see this flat cornea, nor were we surprised by the fact that there was a significant corneal astigmatism. But we expected this astigmatism to be irregular given that she had an RK surgery done. So to our pleasant surprise, when we performed her topography, and as you can see in the black circle, the cornea within this mesopic pupillary area is actually a completely regular astigmatism. So this is actually an ideal candidate for a toric lens, and yet we hesitated. Because as we know, the success of a toric lens depends not only on our precision of magnitude and axis determination, but also on precise spherical equivalent power calculation. And both of these would be a challenge in somebody who has an RK surgery done. But again, very fortunately, we live in an era where we have access to some of these very advanced new generation calculation formulas provided by some of our brilliant peers, which help us land as close to emmetropia as is possible. And so with all this due diligence done, we suggested the option of toric lens to this patient, making sure she understood that despite our best efforts, she may have to sometimes use refractive error if we actually landed with some. She opted for a toric lens implantation, and as you can see, a beautiful image of toric lens on its intended axis. But what was even more beautiful was the patient's response. She told us that she couldn't remember the last time she had seen so well without glasses ever before. So a very important lesson learned from this happy experience was that even if somebody has a compromised cornea, let's say by a corneal opacity, or a prior RK or a LASIK surgery, if the cornea within the mesopic pupillary area is a regular astigmatism, then we can consider implanting a toric lens. However, in such cases, we must pay a lot of attention to the formulation aspect in terms of acquiring accurate data using the right calculation formula, such that we land in a situation where we want a refractive outcome to be optimal for the patient. The second patient I share with you is somebody who had a compromised capsular bag. A young man who came to us with a history of injury about 2 to 3 weeks ago, and as you can see the cataract in the center, but what you will now see is that there is a pre-existent PC defect already. So we were more concerned with how we were going to safely remove this cataract and implant the lens in the bag or not. And so when we saw that he had also regular corneal astigmatism, we were not certain whether advising a toric lens would be the right thing to do or not. But then we saw that the axis of implantation in this particular case would actually be perpendicular to the line of axis of the PC defect. So we were hopeful. We explained this possibility to the patient, ensuring that he understood that only if we thought that the capsular support was adequate, will we put the toric lens, otherwise a monofocal lens. He agreed to keep toric lens as a standby option. And fortunately, he also agreed to femtosecond laser-assisted cataract surgery, which allowed us to employ the concentric ring pattern for lens division, which we could then subsequently peel off in a very sequential controlled manner using low aspiration parameters that you can see on the right-hand side of the box, low bottle height, low aspiration flow rate, lower vacuum, such that the pre-existent PC defect did not extend any further, nor was there any vitreous prolapse. Following a safe removal of the cataract from the bag, using high viscosity, cohesive viscoelastic, and I cannot emphasize enough how important it is to use a cohesive viscoelastic agent, the toric IOL was manipulated gently on its intended axis. It's the cohesive viscoelastic that can actually be removed as a bolus and will not be retained in pockets inside the capsular bag, causing any postoperative rotation. And as always, we would end this surgery with injection triamcinolone to make sure that there are no vitreous strands left behind undetected. Following this surgery, as you can see here, a very stable toric lens in the bag on its intended axis. And the very important lesson learned from this very challenging scenario was that in select situations where there is a PCR, but if we can convert this into a strong continuous PCCC margin, and if the rest of the capsular bag support is adequate, we can consider a toric lens implantation. But we must always make sure that we are paying a lot of attention to the surgical aspect of these kind of eyes in terms of using closed chamber technique, appropriate aspiration parameters, using the right viscoelastic devices. But choosing the right type of toric lens is also very important. When I say right type, what I mean is we want the lens to unfold very gently, gradually, such that there is enough time and stability inside the eye to manipulate. We don't want the lens to open in a jerky manner. And we also want the lens design and material to be such that it will remain exactly where we leave it behind without any chance of postoperative rotation. So choosing the right type of parameters and right type of lens would be very important for a successful outcome in such scenarios. The third patient I share with you is somebody who had another eye refractive outcome that was compromised. A middle-aged female who came to us with a complaint of blurred vision in both her eyes despite one eye being operated previously. And she was not using any glasses whatsoever, but on refraction, we found that her operated eye actually had significant residual refractive error. However, it was this notch in the pupillary area which made me a little suspicious, and sure enough, on dilatation, we find that there was a PCR. The lens was in the sulcus, but more importantly, it was a toric lens. So what we have here is a decentered toric lens in the sulcus causing a significant residual refractive error. So when we saw the other eye also having corneal astigmatism that was significant, we were faced with this dilemma. Should we now advise a monofocal lens and have her use glasses for both her eyes? Or should we implant a toric lens, try to reach emmetropia, and try to reduce her dependence on glasses binocularly? The patient opted for a toric lens implantation, and following an uneventful surgery, we were happy with the refractive outcome of this eye, but the patient was extremely happy with her binocular unaided performance. So a very important lesson learned from such a scenario is that even if one eye has a significant residual refractive error, we must try to aim at emmetropia and use a toric lens if we need to, and try to give a kind of outcome where binocularly the patient is not so dependent on glasses all the time throughout their day. Another very important lesson is that a toric lens is only meant to be implanted in the capsular bag in a very well-centered manner. So if there is a PCR and if we cannot for some reason implant the lens in the bag, then we must abort that plan, implant a monofocal lens instead. So finally, to summarize, I would say that if an eye has a significant and a regular corneal astigmatism that can be corrected with a toric lens, and if we can ensure precision at every level, right from evaluation to formulation to implantation, then this particular IOL technology, the toric lenses, are extremely rewarding and satisfying even in these kind of compromised eyes. Thank you so much.